Eu me chamo Igor Steinmacher e é com prazer que eu venho aqui apresentar o workshop de software livre e a sua palestra de abertura. O workshop de software livre é um workshop que acontece desde a primeira edição, desde o ano 2000, junto com o FISLI, e que tem por objetivo promover e discutir o estado da arte, da ciência, nas mais diversas áreas que o software livre e a produção livre contemplam. Os objetivos desse workshop são trazer pessoas relacionadas não somente à área técnica, mas também à produção científica na área de produção e desenvolvimento de software livre, promover o encontro entre essas pessoas, identificar pontos de cooperação entre as diversas pessoas que participam desse workshop, identificar os desafios atuais para o projeto de software livre e como trabalhar isso aí para o desenvolvimento da sociedade, e discutir futuras pesquisas na área de desenvolvimento de software livre e outras plataformas de conteúdo livre. Nesse ano, na edição desse ano, que é a 16ª, a gente teve 28 artigos submetidos, dos quais 15 foram aceitos, incluindo diversos temas. Temos artigos relacionados à ética hacker, sustentabilidade em projetos de software livre, diversidade de gênero em projetos de software livre e desenvolvimento de hardware de baixo custo. Nossas sessões, elas acontecem na sala 40A. Essa é a palestra de abertura. Depois daqui, a gente vai ter três sessões hoje, três sessões amanhã, na sala 40A. Hoje, começando às 15 horas, então depois dessa palestra, a gente tem um intervalo de 1 hora, para que vocês possam interagir com o nosso palestrante. E depois a gente começa as sessões. E amanhã, também na sala 40A, a gente tem três sessões, entre as 2 da tarde e as 5 da tarde. As pessoas que estiverem interessadas em saber o que está acontecendo na área de pesquisa relacionada a software livre, na academia, a gente traz alguns dos tópicos aí para vocês. Espero que vocês prestigiem esse evento. E agora eu tenho o prazer de apresentar o nosso palestrante, Cornelius Schumacher, que é gerente de engenharia do SUSE. Ele está envolvido com software livre desde o ano de 1999. Ele foi presidente da KDE EV até o ano passado. E ele vai nos presentear com a palestra Learning to Grow, que eu vou deixar ele dar mais detalhes a partir de agora. Cornelius Schumacher.
Thank you. So, welcome. While we're waiting for the slides, I want to say I'm happy to be here and open this WSL conference. And I would like to talk about a topic. When I was invited, I thought, okay, it would be appropriate to talk about something related to education and free software. And this is actually a topic which is dear to my heart, because it's something where I benefited a lot from. So I owe a lot of my career, of my learning, of my growth, personally and also professionally, to the free software community and what I learned from there. So I want to talk about that. I want to talk about the learning environment free software provides, how you can participate there, and what makes this a great learning environment. And I will give you a few examples about people who built their career on free software, and it's something which I think can be used as an example for many other pieces. I think there's a tremendous potential there. Why does this matter? I think it's important because we spend a lot of time on learning. As a kid, we do more or less nothing else. We go to school, we go to university, we learn a lot for our jobs, during our jobs. We also have to learn when we are doing our private stuff. And there are so many challenges in the world that we always have to adapt and to learn and to grow so we can keep up with what is challenging us. And learning and a good education, I mean, it's important, especially in this software industry, in this computer industry. There are not a lot of jobs where you can get away with just doing something which is prescribed and following some instructions. You have to think, you have to be creative. And for that, learning and growing, developing your professional skills is essential. And free software provides a great learning ground for that. And you will get better jobs, better paid jobs, jobs where you have more fun. And you will have a happier life if you are learning through free software. A few words about me before I start going into the details. My name is Cornelius Schumacher. I'm from Germany, born there. My education actually is in physics. So when I started, I have a degree in physics. I worked for a few years in high energy physics, working at LHC. But actually what I did there was not really physics anymore, but I did software. And I got in touch with free software there for the first time. It was actually a colleague of mine who introduced me to KDE. He said, oh, there's this project. They are doing a Linux desktop, and this will be interesting. And I started to use it, I started to contribute to it, and I got sucked into this community. I started with some patches, I started with a few changes here and there, I got into K-Organizer, Contact, and so on. I maintained application, I created new ones, and this built up, and I did more and more, and did other projects as well outside of KDE, like the Open Build Service, and so on. So a lot of technical work there, and at some point, I also got into the organizational side of things. So I realized that it needs more than just writing code to have a successful free software project. It also needs some organizational work. It needs some administrative stuff. So I got elected into the board of KDE EV, which is the organization supporting KDE. And I was there for actually 9 years until last year, half of that as the president. And following that, my career developed as well. So I started as a scientist in high energy physics, doing electronics, doing software. But then I joined the Linux industry. I became a developer there, and I'm still there. And I've developed into an engineering manager at SUSE. That's my day job today. So my career is built a lot on free software. But I started as this. I was a 14-year-old kid playing with computers. That's how I started. And I was not special in any way. I mean, I was interested in computers, but I didn't have a clue. I had a clue how to beat aliens in computer games, but programming wasn't my strength there. But I was interested in that, and I made it a career. And I will tell you a little bit more about how this happened and how free software helped me to do that and how free software can help others to do the same. I will use examples from KDE, that's where I'm coming from. So this is our Linux desktop we do since almost 20 years now. And this is the software. There's a lot of technology we have developed over the time. But it's more than that. It's also a community. It's a group of people. So this is a picture of an academy, a KDE conference we do every year. And the community, the group of people behind that is just as important as the technology. And these two things, the technology, the software on one side, and the community, the group of people you work with, that holds it together, and that creates a really powerful learning environment. And I will tell you how this powerful learning environment actually works, and tell you a bit more about the powers of free software. The first one is freedom. So this is the base. That's where we are coming from. Free software is based on the four freedoms, so that you can use software for whatever you want. You can study it, you can share it, you can distribute copies, you can distribute your changes. And this gives you access to a tremendous amount of software. You can actually do that. You can take software, free software, you can change it, you can work with it, you can use it as material for education, you can use it professionally, you can use it in many different ways. And it also gives you the right to contribute. This is the base. The four freedoms codified in the free software licenses, they give you the freedom to actually build a community on top of that. And that's how it works. And this allows everybody to contribute to software in a way which is very hard to do in proprietary settings. And I started to do that as well. And this is my first patch. You probably can't read it, and that's probably good because it's crap. It's something which I fixed a crash in a program, and then I wrote an email to the mailing list, which was in the about box of the program, and said, okay, this is how you can fix it. Change this line to this, so I didn't have any idea about diff or patch or anything. So this is where I actually learned a lot. Nowadays I know how to use that. But still, this ended up in the application, and it was shipped to users. And it was the start of me contributing to free software. And this wouldn't have been possible if I wouldn't have had the sources available, if I wouldn't have had the right to use them, to change them, to contribute, and to distribute the patches. So this is something which provides a pretty low barrier, so you can use free software in any way, and especially for learning and for education and for growing yourself. The second power of free software is that there are virtually unlimited resources. So there is a scaling effect by the internet, that suddenly you have access to software all over the world, all over the place, no matter where you are, and you have a tremendous amount of resources. That's unusual for educational institutions. There you usually have pretty restricted funds and pretty restricted ways how to get commercial software and stuff like that. Free software is free, so this is different here. And alone on GitHub, there are more than 24 million public repositories. So this is 24 million people or groups of people who created a repository, put some code in there, and you can actually look at that. You can use it, you can change it, you can learn from it, you can study it. So this is a resource which is, I think, it was never there in the history of software development that you had that much resources available to actually learn from it. And that's for free software. And Isaac Newton said that in the academic context, standing on the shoulders of giants, that allows me to make my research. And this, the same quote is also often made for free software, because there you are also standing on the shoulders of giants. You can stand on what other people have done, and other people can stand on what you have done. So you can build on top of that. You can learn. You don't have to repeat the same what others have done already. You can stand on that and repeat that. And this gives a tremendous amount of resources to the free software community, especially in the context of learning. The third point I want to make is that free software allows to work with the best people which are around in the field. This is something which obviously is important for learning as well. I mean, the people who know it best can probably tell you most about it. They can help you. You can learn from them. You can learn from the original. You can learn from the people who maintain the code. So this is something which is, I think, pretty important. And would you know who the maintainer of the Windows kernel is? Would you know how to reach this person? Would you know if it is a person at all? I have no idea. And I don't think anybody really has an idea outside of Microsoft. But what I do know is who is maintaining the Linux kernel, and we all know that. And we all have Linus's email address. And chances are that you write him an email with some patch or some constructive contribution, he will answer you, and you will have a conversation with him, with the maintainer of the Linux kernel. That's easy. That's impossible in proprietary software. And there's a saying, you are as good as the people you surround yourself with. And there's a lot of truth in that. If you surround yourself with people who are better than you, you will be able to learn from them, because they know more than you. They know things you might also want to know. So this is something which is easy in free software. And I want to give you one example of a person who exemplifies that. So this is Thomas Canabrava from Brazil. And he is a KDE contributor. He worked on some KDE applications. And what he also did, he worked very patiently and passionately on Subsurface, the diving computer application Linus is using for his diving. And he spent a lot of time on that and ported that to Qt. And in this way, he could, because it was free software, work with the best. And he, as a result from that, he also got a job at Intel. So a career built on free software. And you might also know him in this form. That's a different kind of growth, but also awesome. So the fourth power, that's feedback. If you are learning and if you want to grow yourself, you need feedback, because you need to know what is the direction, and you need people to correct you so you can learn from your mistakes. You know what is working and you know what is not working, And feedback is very important for that. So what you need to establish is feedback cycles. And feedback cycles in free software are actually natural and built in. So one example is code review. If you submit a patch to a project, people will review it, people will have a look at it, tell you what is wrong, what is good, and you will get feedback so you can improve, you can provide a better patch the next iteration. So this feedback during code review is very important. And this, there's a very short cycle in free software. The same is with users. If you publish free software, people will use it, and if there's a bug, they will tell you. And they won't go through a support organization. They will write you an email or open a bug report in your bug tracking system, which says, okay, there's a bug there, please fix it. So you have a very direct feedback cycle. And this, of course, enables you to learn things much quicker and react much quicker and develop much quicker than if there would not be a feedback cycle. And on top of that, of course, there are more tools and things what you can do, but one thing which is very important, and that's basically the short cycle of a feedback cycle. So you meet in person, and you do the same you do over the internet, over the tools which work, but you do it in person, and you talk to the people directly, you meet. That's what we are doing here now, and what other people are doing in other areas. And this also is something where you have very, very direct feedback. So this is an example of it's actually a pretty old event, and some KDE hackers there on a trade show, similar to the event here. And there were the people maintaining the code, and users could just talk to them and watch them over the shoulder while they were developing it. So it can't get shorter than that in terms of feedback. So this is very beneficial. The fifth thing, and this has developed over the last years, I think, quite positively, is mentoring. So mentoring obviously is essential for learning. You need people who guide you, who help you, who support you, who tell you how you can develop. So mentoring is essential, and in free software, I think we have started to develop also a mentoring culture. And one example of that is the Summer of Code Google is doing since more than a decade now. And they are paying students some money to do basically an internship with a free software project so they can learn from the community, they can get into the community. And this goes both ways, actually. So the students get mentoring, and the organizations, the free software projects behind that, they get to develop mentoring skills. And this is important. And over the years, hundreds and thousands of students have gone through that and have actually become part of free software. And this is a great way also to learn. I mean, you get access to the developers, as I said, you get access to the best by just engaging in such a mentoring program. And you can work there with a lot of more momentum than if you would just work with yourself. And the Google Summer of Code is one thing. There are more programs like that. One program I really like is Outreachy. So this is a program which is targeted at women, supports women in free software. And I think Karen will talk about that tomorrow or something. There also is the Season of KDE, which I also think is a very nice program. And what I find especially nice about that is that we set it up for students who were not accepted in the Summer of Code because we didn't have any slots for them. But there were so many students who said, oh, I still want to do this. And I don't care if I get paid or not. So I will still do that. And so we arranged also some mentors for them, arranged that they get some kind of certificate at the end. And we had a lot of people who went into the community by that. And this is the mentoring culture I'm talking about, which is happening over time. There's Google Code-In, which is also a program run by Google, but targeted at high school students. And this is nice because it starts at the beginning, when people are still young. So introducing them into free software and the free software community right from the beginning. I think that's a very nice thing. And one example of a person who exemplifies, from my point of view, this mentoring is Vishesh Handa. He comes from India. He is now living in Spain. He is a KDE developer, and he started as a student in Google Summer of Code. So what he did there, he wrote some KDE code, and after he finished successfully this project, he stick around in the community, and he became a mentor in the next round of the Summer of Code. So that's a nice thing. He started being mentored and then started to give back and mentor others as well. So he is maintaining parts of KDE now. He is very innovative there, doing cool stuff, and he basically is working as a full-time developer in Spain now. So he's working on free software and has the freedom to choose a lot what he is doing, because he has successfully gone through this mentoring phases and developed himself in the community. He has grown a lot. So he is an example for building a career on free software. Another thing which is quite important in learning is that you have to make an effort. You have to stretch. Otherwise, you won't learn. And you need an opportunity for that, and you need maybe some pushing for that sometimes. So there is this nice model of the comfort zone and the learning zone and the panic zone. So usually you work in your comfort zone. That's where you feel comfortable, where everything is fine, where you know what to do, where you know how to do it, and you can work productively. But you're not learning that much because you're basically doing what you already can do. And that's fine. But if you go to the learning zone, there it becomes more interesting, because then you do stuff you haven't done before. And that might not feel that comfortable anymore, but it's something where you actually can grow yourself. And it needs a little bit of an opportunity and a push to get there, and that's also where free software provides a lot of opportunities. Because usually, especially in volunteer-driven projects, there's nobody who tells you how to do things or what to do, and who doesn't take over the things nobody else is doing. So that's where you actually have to go to make your project you care about successful. And then there's a panic zone. If you go beyond everything what you can do, then it doesn't get productive anymore. But the nice thing is that you can expand these zones, and the more you get into that, the more you do the real things which bring you forward, the broader your horizon will be. And that's an example for my personal learning zone I get into. This is an actual German word. I didn't believe that, but I got it in an email as a subject from a lawyer. And this was the time when I was in the KDEEV board, something I never expected to do. And I thought, okay, but it needs to be done. Nobody else was doing it, and I wanted KDE to succeed, so I got into the organization and worked with that. And there I had to work with financial stuff, with legal stuff, and our lawyer wrote us an email with a subject like this. So I learned what that meant, and dealt with that. And I developed some skills which actually were quite useful for my career in the end. So I don't want to bore you with what that actually means, but for me it was a personal stretching into the learning zone. And one example for a person which also I think stretched quite a bit is another KDE developer, George Stikos from Canada. So he started with contributing some code to KDE, wrote some applications there, and he got into KHTML and WebKit and worked on that. He founded a company, and the company was acquired by RIM, which later became BlackBerry, and he had the title VP Web Technologies there. Quite an impressive career. Nowadays, he is doing another startup, but this is something by stretching into the world of web technology, which is a quite challenging area. He developed himself in a way that he could build up this impressive career. And this was built on free software. He learned all the stuff he needed in the free software community. He still is a normal guy. This is a picture from a hacking meeting. I guess he was in his comfort zone in this picture. Intrinsic motivation is something which I think is very important, because this allows us to work on something from our own motivation. So when you work on some task, if you're motivated to do that, you will have more fun, you will be more productive. And free software provides the ideal environment for that. Then Pink, he came up with these three categories, what actually makes intrinsic motivation, and that's autonomy, mastery, and purpose. Autonomy, to control how you work and what you work on, mastery, to apply your skills to the best, to develop yourself, and purpose, to work on something which matters. And in free software, all three is a given. Autonomy is there because you can choose what you work. It's free software after all. Mastery, because you can apply your full skills. And purpose, because you do that because you want to scratch your own itch, or you want to go for world domination. There are lots of purposes, but you know that. So, and this creates the intrinsic motivation to actually learn something in a way which is fun and brings you forward and which is effective and productive. Success is important, but failure also is important. For learning, it's essential that you also try things which don't work. Otherwise, you are not ambitious enough and you won't learn things which you don't know yet. So the opportunity to fail is something which actually is a pretty important factor of a learning environment. And free software provides that. You might not get paid for that, but as a volunteer, you can do whatever you want. And if you want to go the long road, you want to do the impossible project, the project to write whatever, the next version of something, and take 10 years for it, that's possible in free software. So you can fail. And my personal story there of one of my failures I did was, at one point in time in KDE, I had the idea that I will solve the syncing problems, syncing address books, syncing calendars, syncing files. And I thought, okay, how hard can that be? And I figured out it's very, very hard. It's much harder than I was able to actually deal with. So I wrote this program, Kitchen Sync, and after a while I realized, okay, this was above my horizon. I couldn't do that. Fortunately, there were some smarter people around me which picked that up and did other stuff from a completely different direction, and they actually solved some of the problems there. And one example of a guy who also built his software, his career on free software, is Frank Karliczek. And he actually eventually solved the syncing problem I had there with OwnCloud, what he founded. Before he did OwnCloud, he did a lot of other projects. He did KDE Look, KDE Apps, Qt Apps, GTK Apps, and so on. He did OpenPC, probably nobody remembers that anymore, Social Desktop, lots of projects. And he experimented with things in the free software community. And a lot of these projects actually did fail. And he could try out things. And with OwnCloud, he found something which actually is working quite well now. So his career is going along his free software engagement, starting as a web developer, founding his company doing web development, and now being the co-founder and CTO of OwnCloud Inc., the company behind the OwnCloud project. So this is another example for a person who built his career on free software. The ninth item is assuming responsibility. And this is a pretty powerful concept. If you learn that you give the learner the responsibility about what he learns and how he learns, because this will create another level of engagement. And this has two sides: taking responsibility, you can actively assume responsibility for something, you can take over maintainership of an abandoned program. And the other side is getting responsibility. So in KDE, for example, when you prove yourself to be a useful committer, you have provided some patches, you will get commit access to the KDE repositories. And you will get commit access to everything at once. So this comes with a certain degree of responsibility, and it's easy to get that. And that's something which is also characteristic for free software communities, that you can take and get responsibility in a pretty easy way. And this will boost your learning quite a bit. And it's something which also is quite important for personal growth and professional growth. You can't grow without taking responsibility. And I want to give one more example of a person which exemplifies that. That's Sulamita Garcia, also from Brazil here. And she did a lot of work in Linux Chicks, the IDEA initiative, to help women in free software. And she took a lot of responsibility there. And she built her career on top of this community work and did a lot of community manager work. And nowadays, she's a developer evangelist at Intel, working in Germany and Munich. So another example for a career built on free software and built on the learning and growing within the free software community. The 10th item is working on the real thing. And that's something which is also something which is sometimes a little bit surprising, but in free software, you actually work on something which matters quite a bit. You usually work on code which is used by other people. And that's not the usual learning setting. Usually you have some artificial exercises, you're in some constrained environment where people have created some tasks for you to solve, but the results will just be thrown away after rating, and they won't change anything. in free software, you work on something which is actually used by people. And this creates a complete new dimension which forces you to learn, which forces you to get better. And for me, one of the personal things where I learned that is the EPC. That's the first netbook many years ago, and it came with KDE software. And I suddenly started to get emails I didn't get before. People asked me, can you help me to use my computer? And I thought, oh, what? Why should I help you to use your computer? Oh, because your name is in my computer. And I realized in some about box, somewhere in some application, there was my name in the list of contributors. So I got in contact with a whole new set of users who had questions, who had requests, who wanted to have new features or didn't get along with something, and I had to deal with it. And that was another way how I got pushed into a zone where I learned something new. And this working on the real thing really is something which I think is special for free software because it's so easy to get into this area. So the 11th point, growing beyond technology, this is something I already talked a little bit about that. So when I talked about my personal learning zone experience. Free software comes from technology. There are lots of people doing technical development, and that's great. But there also are other things, like the organizational work, like marketing, like whatever. I mean, there are lots of things, and usually there are not that many people around to do that, especially if you're in projects which are mostly driven by volunteers. And that's where you can grow into something which you maybe didn't expect. This is a picture of the KDE V board some years ago, and these are all software developers, or they were software developers, because many of them actually turned into managers. And surprisingly, it's quite easy to become a manager by working on a free software project and doing these things beyond coding. So for me, it was kind of my manager education in some sense. I wouldn't have this job if I wouldn't have gained experience about what it means to lead a project, what it means to manage all the situations beyond the pure programming. So this is something which I think is a really nice aspect because free software is a great learning environment, not only for coding, but also for many other things around that. And one other example of a person who built his career on free software is Jono Bacon from the UK. And he was a KDE contributor at the beginning, and he did some community work in the UK organizing Linux user groups and stuff like that. And you probably know him best from his time as community manager at Ubuntu working for Canonical. And nowadays he is a senior director of community at XPRIZE. So again, quite a career built on free software. And the nice thing is that he not only builds his career on free software, but he also helps others to build free software communities and develop themselves. But he also started small. This is a picture of a KDE event many years ago, and the nice boy on the right there, this is Jono Bacon, on the second from the right. He is representing KDE there at an event. So obviously a lot of growth professionally for him, not so much for his hair. So these 11 powers, they are quite powerful. Freedom, virtually unlimited resources, working with the best, feedback cycles, mentoring, stretching to the learning zone, intrinsic motivation, opportunity to fail, assuming responsibility, working on the real thing, growing beyond technology. And you might want some other power from your perspective, what you find interesting or what helped you to learn and grow in the free software community. And I now want to make a little thought experiment because I like to toss ideas around. So what if there would be a way how to put this into a form which is a little bit closer to what education actually expects, how education actually works? So what if there would be a university of free software? What if there would be a curriculum for doing free software, to guide people how to get into free software and benefit from this learning and growing? What if there would be degrees for free software tasks, which would recognize and acknowledge your successes in free software in a way which is consumable by companies and others? What if there would be a faculty of free software practitioners? So people who are active in the free software community and can guide you, can teach you, can help you to get somewhere. So what if there would be an institution which would codify this a bit so that it would be more accessible to students and more consumable by those who need the results of that? Would this be a good thing? I will leave this question open for now. But I won't leave this question open because this is important. So what can you do? How can you benefit from the learning environment free software provides? How can you benefit from the growth opportunities which are there? And there are actually a lot of things. There are a million things you can do. You can do hard stuff and easy stuff. You can do stuff which requires coding, stuff which requires something completely different. You can do things which are creative, which are boring, small, big, where you need to speak another language, where you need to just be able to draw something. There are millions of things. And I'm sure there is something there for everybody. Everybody will find some tiny little bit where he or she can contribute to free software and benefit from that, and get into this, and learn something, and maybe that's the beginning of a career, like from some of the examples I showed. I can only advise you, be bold, try it, don't hesitate, just do it. And why is this important? This is a quote from a US American investor, and he said, software is eating the world. And what he meant by that is that software is dominating our life more and more. A lot of things are dominated by software, and those in control of the software and writing the software, they can influence what is happening. And this goes beyond just the pure software, this also goes to hardware, other things, social things. Software is eating the world. So it's important to be involved with that, it's important to know about that. Being in the software industry actually is a pretty exciting time because you are part of this happening. But the important thing is, if software is eating the world, free software actually becomes even more important because free software means a free world. So I grew from a 14-year-old kid playing computer games to a respected professional in the area with a nice job and a great community and knowing lots of people. And I'm aware that I'm speaking a little bit of a position of privilege here because I'm already there. But as I showed, I started on the other end as well. And I'm sure that there are lots of opportunities for many, many people to do similar paths. I put in a lot of time and a lot of work to actually get where I am. But I actually ended up there with the help of the free software community. I wouldn't be here without the community and without what I have learned and what I have grown in skills in the free software community. So for the individual, I can only encourage you, take benefit of the free software community. Get involved, learn, and grow. And for those who are already in communities, I can only encourage you to help others to grow, help others to learn, to be a friend, to be a mentor, to be a teacher, and share the love, and let's work on growing and learning together through free software. So, I will be around. I am happy to hear your stories, how you learned in free software. I'm also happy to discuss ideas how we can make this better and what we can do there. And that's actually what I wanted to tell you. So, thank you for listening. So, do we have some time for questions? So, we have time for questions. So, are there any questions? Or comments or stories you want to share? Everybody wants respect on their careers. How can we gain that? That's a pretty good question. I think free software actually is an area where respect is worth a lot, because you build a reputation when you're working on free software. And that's in some way the currency in which you are paid for doing free software work, especially for volunteer work. And building on this culture, I think gaining respect for your work is quite natural in free software. And this requires, of course, coding skills. This might also require some social skills. But I think it's kind of built in free software. It's something which, as I said, from my point of view, respect and building up a reputation, that's a currency you are paid in for volunteer work. And that's what you can then use to get a better job. That's what you can then use to build up new projects. It worked very well for me. I mean, as I said, I wouldn't be here without the respect I got through my involvement in free software communities. More questions? So, any questions in Portuguese? Over there. So you're looking for a mentor.
Yes.
So you saw some hands here. So it's pretty easy. I mean, talk to the people, go to the KDE stand, write an email to the KDE community mailing list. There are several ways how to find a mentor. More questions?
This will be in English. Hi, I'm Randall Schwartz. I host the PLOS Weekly Show. And one of the things that we discovered recently was that the TrueCrypt software, which had been abandoned by their developers, had been taken over by a sole developer now with a couple people helping him. And it became Veracrypt. So one of the things you can do to contribute to open source software is to look for abandonware and take over the development of it. And this is truly being a gift to the world, because TrueCrypt was absolutely unique in its category. And to have it now continue to be developed and made better and made more secure, and he's doing it for the labor of love. He's not looking to get any money out of it or anything. It's really a gold star for him.
Yeah, that's a very good point. I mean, there's really a lot of software which can be improved, which is already there, and you can take it up from where it is. And nobody will stop you. So, who is next? Anybody who wants to share something? How you grew through free software? How you built your career on free software?
So I'm going to talk about my experience. I think that most of you, not most, but half and half are students. So when you're students, you have enough time. You can't believe it, you have enough time. So try to take that time and start contributing. Try to join, for example, the Google Summer of Code program, where you can contribute to some open source project, and also you can get paid for that. And also, which is more important, you get a mentor. Somebody who tells you and would guide you about how to accomplish things. And in the other side, and in order to join Google Summit of Code, for example, you need to start contributing before that. And what that means, you know that every open source project has its own repository. Go for it, go to the bugs that are listed or issues on GitHub and try to contribute to someone. Make a specialist on some area of some free software. Try to get that. In my experience, I have been doing free software for a lot of years, but I was also working, for a big company which name starts with O and ends in Oracle. So it was a bit difficult to do and grow an open source in a company which has, they believe in different things. But at the end, I was able to find a very good job opportunity where they did not ask me about my resume. They did not ask me for my LinkedIn profile. They just were asking for a GitHub profile. So how is important to contribute? Because the things that you made public talk about you. So if you can manage to do that, to start contributing and make an expert on some area, definitely you will get some job on that. You can be a sysadmin and you can make an expert on systemd or system administrator task. If you are a developer, look for a specific project that motivates you. If you are motivated, you're going to make huge things. So in my experience, it was that. I was doing a lot of development. I have a good GitHub profile. And people at this company, which I'm representing on this time at this event, they liked that and they hired me. And until now, they had never seen my resume. They just saw what I did. So it's not about what you study, it's not about what you learn, what you say that you learn. It's about what you share on public. So, and also be careful about what you post on blogs, on Twitter, and also on what you code. That's it.
Thanks, that's exactly your point, yeah. If you're working on free software, what you do is visible, and that's a very positive thing. So, we still have some time? So, that means we are done. Thank you again, and have fun with the rest of the conference.